and over to you.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. And I, first of all, I would like to thank the Sonobus people for this amazing online discussions of, it's a feast for all the radiologists. So many workshops, so many lectures, so many eminent faculties talking about lots of topics. And I hope this topic is also useful to all of you. So without wasting much time, I will start my topic. It's imaging of fallopian tubes. Now, histosulfonography is the first and foremost modality for imaging the tubes. It has become a commonly performed examination due to recent advances and improvements in, as well as increasing popularity of reproductive medicine. HSG plays an important role in the evaluation of abnormalities related to the uterus and fallopian tubes. Uterine anomalies that can be detected at HSG include congenital anomalies, polyps, leiomyomas, surgical changes, synecdoche, and adenomyosis. Tubal abnormalities that can be detected include tubal occlusion, SIN, polyps, hydrosulfings, and peritubal adhesions. Now, his HSG is the radiographic evaluation of uterus and fallopian tubes, you all know, and it is predominantly used in the evaluation of infertility. But apart from that, HSG is also used in the evaluation of women with a history of recurrent spontaneous abortions, post-operative evaluation of women who have undergone tubal ligation or reversal of tubal ligation that has been done in order to assess the patency, and even after myomectomy, prior and after the myomectomy, in order to know the size of the cavity. The primary role of HSG is in the evaluation of fallopian tubes. Ultrasonography is currently used for the evaluation of endometrium, as beautifully told by Dr. Khurana sir, and he has very beautifully elaborated the topic as such. And we can also use the ultrasound for the evaluation of abnormal uterine bleeding, polyps, pregnancy, whereas MRI is a modality which is used for the evaluation of uterine and myomectrium, that is uterine contour, myomas, and other pathologies, as well as the ovaries. So in our practice, with the increased demand for HSG, radiologists should be familiar with the HSG techniques and interpretation of HSG images. Are tubes merely a pipe? This is a question which we all need to know. Even if fallopian tubes are patent, it doesn't mean that they are normal. Most people think of fallopian tubes as simple tubes that allow eggs and sperm to meet and a fertilized egg to reach the uterus. However, in actuality, a fallopian tube is much more a dynamic organ. The effect of this negative pressure and sucking action plays its best when the fimbrial end expands and covers the ovulation site of the ovary well. So it is not only sufficient to know the tubes are patent, but we also need to know about the mobility of the fallopian tubes, the condition of the tubal lumen and the fimbriae, and the tubo-ovarian relationship. So a functional test versus patency test. While a full testing of tubal function in patients with infertility is not possible, testing of tubal patency is important, as tubal obstruction is a major cause of infertility. Now, various tests for tubal patency that are available, we know first is the gold standard hysterolaparoscopy, and then we cannot do hysterolaparoscopy in each and every patient. We need some screening techniques. So that is why we have other imaging studies for fallopian tubes, that is HSG, the hysterosonogram, the selective hysterosulfingogram, the magnetic resonance HSG, saline or contrast sonohysterogram, hysterosulfingocontrast sonography, 3D and 4D contrast ultrasonography, and the traditional Rubin's test. Now, you all know that for 30 to 40% of the female factors are contributed by the tubal factors for infertility. And there is increasing trend of PID, ectopic, IUCDs, and endometriosis, pelvic surgeries, and sulfingitis, which contribute to the putubal pathologies. Now, what are the contraindications where we are not doing tubal patency test? These are women who are having their period, women who are pregnant, and women who are having pelvic infections. So HSG not only opacifies the endometrial cavity, it also shows the anatomy of the fallopian tubes, and it also shows the spill pattern if the tube is patent. So it is an advantage to study the endometrial cavity as well as to diagnose the Mullerian abnormalities, endometrial lesions, to assess the entire tube, the condition of the lumen, and the spill pattern. So it is an outpatient procedure. It is relatively inexpensive. It does not require GA unless and until patient herself demands for that. It is associated with a therapeutic effect. There had been a lot of studies which say that many patients, they conceive immediately after one or two cycles post HSG. It may be due to the positive pressure effect that is being imparted by the contrast on the fallopian tubes, leading to washout of the debris and thus leading to pregnancy. Now, what HSG we need is to know that HSG needs to have a correct interpretation. Spilling of the dye, however, does not always indicate a normal fallopian tube. It takes an experienced expert to correctly interpret a normal tubal anatomy on HSG. Indeed, I would like to say the interpretation of HSG films is the most frequently falsely interpreted test in medicine. We constantly see patients with diagnosis of normal tubes on HSG. But when we see those films very clearly or very closely, they turn out to have some or the other obvious tubal diseases. So our radiology colleagues need to focus on whether the tubes are open when they perform and interpret the readings. Question is whether the tubes are normal, not only the tubes are patent. So normal tubes, of course, have to be open, but open tubes may not be necessarily normal. That is a dictum to be followed while reporting. Now, timing, the examination should be scheduled during 7 to 12 days of the menstrual cycle. The endometrium is thin during this proliferative phase, and that facilitates the image interpretation, and there is also no pregnancy in this period. So if the patient has irregular menstrual cycles, go for a serum beta HCG level and confirm it. We do not always require a prophylactic antibiotic treatment. Major equipment is a C-arm, a fluoroscopy room, or even an X-ray table. And other is the HSG tray, which consists of all the. Okay. So what is the exact interpretation? At HSG, fallopian tube should appear as thin, smooth lines. They should widen in the ampullary portion. The ischemic portion is likened to a spaghetti in appearance. The fallopian tubes, they vary in location within the pelvis, and they have vary in their tortuosity also. There should be free spillage of contrast material into the peritoneal cavity. Tubar abnormalities can be either due to congenital spasm, occlusion, or an infection. So this is a normal hysterosalpingogram. These are the four parts of the tube: cornu, isthmus, ampulla, and the fimbria. And this is the spillage pattern. The spills, generally they outline the gut loops. So what are the points that are to be looked at while reporting HSG? Uterine cavity, the number, the size, shape, margin, lastly filling defects, fallopian tubes, that extend the spillage of the dye into the peritoneal cavity or not, and the amount, the type of the spillage, if there is any block, the level of the block, and any appearances of hydrosulfings or any abnormalities such as tobacco pouch, beaded appearance, lymphatic venous intravasation of dye or not. So SIN is a disease of unknown origin, and it is very occasionally seen in Indian patients, and possibly due to ectopic or any tubercular setting, we can see the findings of SIN on fallopian tubes. So these are the various findings. These are the diverticular pouches. Now, corneal block, this is which we commonly occur, is should be evaluated whether it is true or pseudo. Corneal portion of the tube is encased by the smooth muscle of the uterus. So if there is any spasm of the muscle during HSG, one or more tube may become not filled with the contrast, and then we get a pseudo block. So in order to distinguish between pseudo and a true block, we have to administer a spasmolytic, that is to be part of the pre-medication, or we can continue administration of contrast, which sometimes leads to opening of this spasm and opacification of the distal tube. And again, we have a procedure known as selective fallopian tube cannulation, that is selective sulfingography, which also helps in knowing the pseudo and differentiating the tubal spasm and the tubal blocks. So tubal occlusion will manifest as an abrupt cutoff of contrast medium with non-opacification of the distal tube. It may be unilateral, bilateral, any part of the tube may be blocked. So hydrosulfing, it is a tubular dilatation of the fallopian tubes, mostly occurs in the ampullary and the femoral part. The blockages might be bilateral or unilateral. Unicornuate uterus is very well diagnosed on HSG, in which the axis of the uterus is deviated to one side. There is a single cornua which is seen at the top of the uterine cavity, and a single fallopian tube is seen originating from it. Various Mullerian abnormalities can also be diagnosed. There are criteria for distinguishing bicornuate and septate uterus. And there are various findings that are very peculiarly seen in tuberculosis about fallopian tubes and uterus. Specifically, we get a beaded tube appearance, the Golculap tube, the piped stem tube, the cobalt stem tube, leopard skin tube, and non-specifically, we can get hydrosulfings, which we can also get in other PIDs, and mucosal thickening and peritubal adhesions. In uterus, we can see a proper T-shaped uterus due to marked synecchi and distortion of the endometrial cavity, a pseudo-unicornuate appearance, a trifoliate uterus, and non-specific findings are again synecchi, distortion of the contour, and there might be a venous and lymphatic intravasation of contrast. So this is a tufted tube appearance. We can see the tube in the form of a lot of tufts are there, which is due to a pooling of contrast in the mucosal folds. Then this is a cotton woolish type appearance. Contrast has been accumulated in again the mucosal folds, leading to this pattern. The hydrosulfings on one side, multiple diverticulae on the other side. Then cotton woolish appearance of this contrast pooling. These are multiple strictures followed by dilatations, leading to formation of a beaded tube appearance, very classical of tuberculosis. This is again corkscrew tube, a vertically oriented tubes with tortuosity. Then there might be multiple adhesions, synecchi leading to distortion of uterine cavity. These are straight pipe-like tubes with tufted ends. This is pseudo-unicornuate, a distorted uterine contour. One cornu is not at all visualized. The other cornu is seen. There are multiple adhesions leading to distortion of the endometrial cavity. There might be... So we come to the sonohysterosulfingography, in which we use ultrasound to watch the movement of normal saline that is injected into the uterus. Sonohysterosulfingography does not use X-ray. It does not use any iodine dye. So it is an outpatient procedure. It is associated with minimal patient discomfort and very low risk of infection is there. It is non-invasive. It is easy to perform in almost any medical setting. It does not require sedation or anesthesia. It does not have any adverse effects or any serious related complications. For this, we need an 8 French catheter, which is inserted just above the level of the internal os. We distend the balloon either by water or air, and we introduce the probe into the vagina after removing the speculum and tinaculum, but with the catheter in situ. We slowly inject some amount of saline via 20 ml syringe, and we concentrate on scanning the uterus and ovary in transverse section. We concentrate on one side at a time. We observe the fluid dribbling out through the ovary, and we repeat the procedure on the other side. In case there is any doubt about patency of B-mode, we place a Doppler gate at the suspected site, and a brief injection of saline is again made. There is a long drawn noise that gradually decreases in intensity in a patent tube, and a block will be seen as a steep Doppler shift followed by no noise. So similar procedure can be repeated if we use a color Doppler. There will be a sudden gush of contrast with filling of color in a patent tube. Now, sonohysterography or hysteroscopy is the diagnostic accuracy is comparable to the hysteroscopy. Although hysteroscopy enables visualization and evaluation of uterine cavity only, SHG allows evaluation of both uterus as well as adnexa. Results of SHG correlates positively with laparoscopy, and SHG and HSG have been shown to have a 93% correlation. Now coming to another test, that is hysterosonosulfingography with contrast. We use here instead of the saline an EcoVist, that is a specific ultrasonic contrast which enhances the visibility of endometrium as well as the fallopian tubes. So it is a very simple, well-tolerated OPD procedure, again like sonohistrosalpingography. Same procedure is applied. Instead of the saline, we mix air and saline and insert it into the endometrial cavity. The bright echoes generated by the saline and air bubbles make the tubal visualization possible. The procedure is also known as sonohsg. Coming to other modalities, the MR-HSG, in which again after injection of the MR contrast, we take the patient inside the MR room and scan the uterus and ovaries. So this is also a very good procedure, but it is very tedious, and studies are still going on and not much use in India as such, but it is giving promising results as such, as equivalent to the X-ray HSG. In addition, it picks up uterine and extrauterine pathologies, determining the management protocol in infertility. I haven't done any MR-HSG as such, as per these are only studies that those are going on. It has been also said to add advantage of avoidance of radiation exposure, that is also there. And then again, we are having a virtual HSG using CT scan. It's a multi-detector CT. Capacity of the CT is useful for detecting both the internal and external surfaces of the uterus, fallopian tubes, and other pelvic organs, providing high-resolution data that are suitable for 2D, 3D. Again, these are reconstructed images. Their temporal resolution is not as good as those of the HSG. So, but only advantage is we can view the uterus, adnexa, as well as the fallopian tubes, and we can evaluate the extra uterine factors as well as extra tubal factors in the same sittings. So it's a non-invasive procedure for evaluating tubal patency. It is painless. So take home message is hysterolaparoscopy is the gold standard, but it is not useful as a screening test for each and every patient. We cannot do that for tubal assessment. So we have to use other screening methods, which are more commonly the sono HSG, the HSG, and the contrast enhanced HSG. So HSG remains the time tested method, but it requires expert interpretation. We already had a dictum showing patent tubes are not always normal tubes, but normal tubes are always patent. All these three are comparable to each other in selective those women who further need laparoscopy. Now coming to selective sulfingography, we are doing this lot of cases since 2000. And this is a very useful procedure, and a lot of patients have been benefited with that. Patient do not undergo laparoscopy after this if they get a patent tube. In this, we insert a selective sulfingography catheter up to the level of cornu via HSG catheter. It's a coaxial technique, and then we opacify the cornu, inject the contrast, and we opacify the tube. If the tube is blocked, we insert a guide wire via the corneal catheter, and we assess the patency as well as we achieve the recanalization. So these are few videos I would like to play. So this is the catheter which is placed in the cornu. It's a J-shaped SSG catheter. We are pushing the guide wire. We are assessing the tubal motility also. You can very well see the tubes are moving normally. The guide wire is removed and we push in the contrast. See, this is the peritoneal spillage. The anatomy of the tube is also very well outlined. So it's a simple procedure for tubal obstruction in patients with tubal obstruction. Other side, we are also doing this. The guide wire is being inserted. See the motility of the fallopian tube. It is freely moving, followed by the injection of contrast media. This is transcervical fluoroscopic guide wire mediated fallopian tube recanalization. So these are selective sulfingography, and FTR is a safe and effective method. Fallopian tube recanalization is recommended as a first intervention in patients with proximal fallopian tube obstruction. In experienced hands and with dedicated equipment, and in an appropriate setting, the success rate is high, and the treatment should be offered to every woman with PFTO before any other complex techniques are attempted. And these are the recommendations by American College of Radiology. The HSG stands first, followed by the sonohistrosalpingography, followed by the transvaginal ultrasound, and the role of MRI, and these they come after the transvaginal ultrasound, which has got an edge above MRI also. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for taking this really important topic. And we might have just forgotten few important points, because we usually learn these during our residency days and then do not have time to revise the technicalities. So thank you once again. There are few questions coming up. So regarding the size of the catheter, they wanted you to just kind of repeat.
HSD catheter, now routinely we have ready-made catheters of 8 French. Then we have specialized balloon catheters, which have a single balloon or the double balloon. Double balloon catheters mostly I am using during recanalization procedures. We can also go for a 6 French Foley's catheter. Also, traditionally, we can use a Leech Wilkinson metallic cannula, or we can also use that vacuum cup hysterocath that was used. That I had used in my PG days, but now we are not using that vacuum club because it is a bulky instrument. We are going towards more sleeker type of cannulas. Those are either single balloon or double balloon. Single balloon HSG cannulas are very cheap. They can come around the rate of 700-800 at disposable single time. You don't need to sterilize them. You just use a single use and they are very easily available.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, if you can just summarize about the pre-medications for HSG, like before we give the appointment, while we are giving the appointment to the patient on table before doing the procedure and after the procedure is done.
See, that time you need to counsel either by yourself. If you're too busy, you just train your manager or somebody. You should be very clear about the LMP. You should be very clear about the regularity of the cycles. If the patient has regular cycles, offer her an appointment between 7th to 10th day of the menstrual cycle. If the cycles are not regular, get a beta HCG or a pregnancy test prior day. And then ask for to prepare parts. And on that particular day, there is no need of NPO. Just she had to take a light food just 3 hours prior to that. She can also take a painkiller with that. She should report an hour prior to the appointment. And we should give her injection atropine as well as any spasmolytic. I am using buscopan in my setting. That should be half an hour prior to the table whenever we take the patient inside.
Okay, ma'am. And ma'am, do we need to give any antibiotic cover or anything after the procedure?
There are no guidelines for prophylactic antibiotic treatment. Ideally, if the patient is suffering from active PID, we do not take the patient for HSG. We should first treat the episode of infection and then we should plan an HSG. For chronic PIDs, there is no indication for any particular antibiotic. That is a domain of gynecologist to decide if the patient needs antibiotic prior or after. We routinely are not prescribing as a radiologist.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you for that. Ma'am, any specific instruction like we did for HSG proper for sonosalpingography?
Sonosalpingography, actually placement of your probe is very important. And you should be... prior reporting, you should have seen lot of cases also. You should have be with some good mentor and then we should report. And you can take, if you have a power Doppler or color Doppler setting, that is really very useful for assessing the patency instead of the normal 2D mode, gray mode.
So I think that has sorted out most of the queries. And we thank you once again for taking this important topic for us.
Thank you so much, people, for giving me this opportunity. And sorry, there was some glitch in the Wi-Fi and that got disconnected.